This conference will now be recorded.
Today, we are going to learn about analysis of while loop. Yesterday, we have learned about what is algorithm, why should I analyze the algorithm before writing it, and how to analyze it. What are the basic factors required for analyzing? We have seen today. That is nothing but time complexity and space complexity are the basic requirement which has to be done for analyzing a program. So in those things we have covered for loop alone. Today we are going to continue from while loop. So let me share the screen. So these are the topics which are completed. In case of for loop, we are seeing with different scenarios, right? So whenever I'm iterating from 0 to n, what could be the complexity calculation of time here, order of n. If I'm incrementing by 2, what could be the complexity? If I'm going from 0 to n or n to 1 or n to 0, what happened? Your complexity will never change. So these are the scenarios we are seeing. And today, the same thing I'm going to implement by using while loop. So guys, am I audible? Can you people respond to me? Will you people? Guys, am I audible? Okay, fine, fine. A small network issue, guys. Give me a second. Okay, fine. These are the topic which we people are discussing yesterday. So what you're going to do is you're going to implement the same concept by using while loop. And look, what is the complexity we are getting? So let me declare a while loop. While, and here, whenever we have while, I need a separate iterator, right? So let me declare I assign 0 one line here and followed by it. So just let me scroll a little down. So let me write condition, termination condition. So let it goes to I less than n and followed by inside it, let us assume we are having statement. They're having statement in it and follow by here we are supposed to have incrementation part separately. Guys, a general while loop. Now we are going to have a time complexity. Guys, I didn't write based on any programming language. Don't think that I'm writing. This is a general format I'm writing. So if at all you are relating with it, just relate with C and C++ as a common. Even in case of while loop, just in case of Python, we'll have one colon symbol will be there, right? This is going to vary. This particular structure is common for all programming language. I didn't write for any specific programming language. Now let us calculate the complexity of this algorithm. So now if at all you're calculating complexity, what is the unit of time taken for this? It will be one unit of time it will be taken, right? So and for this, how many times this while loop will be executed? So this while loop will be executed until I value is greater than n, which is nothing but until n plus 1 time this loop will be executed. And how many times this statement is going to be executed? This statement will be executed n times. So the loop breaks at n plus 1 time and this statement will be executed n times. And this I also will be executed n times. So the both the person inside the loop will be executed n times, right? So now let us have a calculation part of it. So we will be calculating, we'll leave out, we will never consider the looping part, right? The looping condition, the if condition or while loop, whatever the value we added, we'll consider only this statement. We'll leave out, we'll never consider this line. Even if you're considering this line also, your value, your order is not going to be changed. So we'll never consider this line. It is not necessary to consider. If required, you can consider, guys. So let me show you the calculation part. So how many n's are there? You're going to add these two n, right? So you'll be getting your time complexity as f of n will be 2n. Okay, 2n is going to be there. If at all you feel that I want to consider this also. So let us consider how many n's are there? 1n, n plus n plus n plus 1 plus 1. So how many ones you're going to get? You're going to get 3n's. So if you want to consider, I'm saying, okay, you can consider 3n plus 1. So here, what is the degree of polynomial will be taken? Here it is nothing but order of n. Omit all the constant and the higher degree of polynomial will be taken as order of n. Is this clear? Come on, answer me. The same. Same as a for loop. In for loop, we didn't single line. Here it is going for multiple line. That's it. Now from this, the condition, everything is based the same as your for loop. Come on soon, guys. Be a little interactive. The example for while loop, guys. The reason is you should know how to calculate time complexity. If some question, if some problem statement is given, you will be in a position to calculate the complexity of it. So don't be worried, what is this notation? Okay, right now just assume that this particular loop is executing n time. I let you know what is this O of. We'll be mentioning as big O, theta, and followed by, we'll be having certain notation, big O, theta, omega notation. I'll let you know what is those notation all about. Just right now, as a general, I'm writing big O of n, order of n. Okay. And let me give one more scenario. If at all your a value is 1 and your while loop is going to execute till my a value less than b. This is a scenario. And inside this, let us assume we are having statement inside it and followed by here I'm trying to manipulate by using a value. For each and every iteration, a is multiplied twice. Clear with it? Which is nothing but the same logic as we see here before. In case of your, just a minute.
Ma'am, you are not audible, ma'am. Ma'am, we can't hear you, ma'am. Ma'am.
Hear me now? Is that okay? Okay, fine. Okay guys, we are calculating this, how many times this loop will be executed. So we are seeing that this loop will be executed some x number of times, right? So it will be executed some x number of times. So let us consider this loop is executed till 2 power k. 2 power k times this loop will be executed. I doesn't know how many times it will be executed. Based on your b value, it is going to be executed. So we are considered this termination condition as, so when this particular loop is going to terminate, this loop is going to terminate when your a value is greater than or equal to b value. So how many times this particular a is going to execute? It is going to execute till 2 power k times. This is nothing but how many times a will be executed. This is the calculation we did it. So just substitute this value here. 2 power k greater than or equals to, let it be as such now b. Okay, we didn't consider as m. So the termination condition we didn't have considered as n, they let us kept as b, will consider as b itself. Now I should find out that how many times this particular k has executed, which is nothing but how many times this particular a will be executed. So for that, what I should do is I should find the value of k. So simply what I can assume is, I can assume 2 power of k, instead of here mentioning, instead of mentioning e equal, greater than or equal to, let me assume as equal to. This is just an assumption, guys. Just let me, instead of mentioning greater than or equal to, let me assume that this particular as an equation. Okay, I'll remove this greater than. Now I'm supposed to find my k value. I'm supposed to bring my 2 towards my right end. So if I'm bringing my 2 towards my right end, I'll get log base 2 of b. So this is the equation we have found. So instead of b, you can substitute n also. It's up to you. Okay. So what is the equation you have found? So it is in the order of log base 2 of n. Is this clear, guys, how to calculate it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So you can notice that the same order you might have got here also during your multiplication, where your order is not going to change for loop or while loop. The loop is always same. The only variation is how we are going to implement, either by using while loop or for loop, that's it. But the order, whatever the logic we're going to write in, either by for loop or by using while loop, you'll be getting same order. So can you people guess for this answer? What could be the answer? The next scenario I'm going to give, just try to calculate the answer for it. When your I value is greater than 1, just let me have some division operation. We have seen multiplication. Now let me go ahead with division. I divide by 2. What could be the order of this one? We have calculated already. I divided it by 2. What could be the order of this one, ma? By using for loop, we did. Can you people guess it? What could be the order of this? No need of calculating again. Can you people try it? What could be the order of this? What is the order we got in case of for loop? Could you remember?
Of n, ma'am.
Log of n. Good. So you'll be getting as answer as log of n. The same answer, guys. Calculation is not going to vary. If at all you're getting this one, you'll be getting log of n. Yeah, guys, you can avoid this base 2, base 3. It is not required. Just for your clear understanding, I'm mentioning log of base 2, log of base 3. This base 2, base 3, everything comes under log of n. As simply this notation can be given as log of n, where all the three notation will be given with the same equation log of n. They will avoid this base. Some cases they will avoid this one. They'll never mention base 2, base 3. Okay, so you'll be getting answer log of n, or you can mention log of, where do I mention? So this one I have cut it here. So you can mention log of n, or you can mention log of base 2 n. Both are right. Okay, the same calculation path. And let me give one more scenario, a small scenario. So by seeing this one, we'll go ahead with asynchronous notation. Okay, fine. Now, what is the equation can I write? Guys, try to calculate it. Just I was saying you people how to calculate it. Will you people try it? While loop. Let me mention your k value less than n value. And inside this statement is written, followed by k value is incremented each and every time with I times. And each and every time your I value is incremented plus 1. Shall we calculate it? If at all the equation, if at all it is going from I to n, that is very easy for the people to do it. If equation is given like this, if you have some scenario where your k value is dependent on your I value, in this scenario, what it can be? A simple thing, whenever you find like this scenario, have a habit of immediately writing, solving this step-by-step process. right I and k. Okay, here we people should find how many times this k value is executed. If you are finding it, then it will be easy for us to find the order of it. So whenever your I value is 1, what could be a k value? 1 plus, okay, 1, right? Your k value is 1 and your I value is 1, it will be 1 plus 1. When your I value is 2, what could be the answer here? So when I, so initially there will be no step, guys. Sorry. When your I value is 1, let us assume, just a minute, when I value is 1. When your I value is 1, it will be 1 plus 1. Will be made miss any step? Okay, less than n. 1 plus 1. Okay. When your I value is 2. So what happened? Already existing value. So 2 plus 2. Right? So for your I value is 3. So what will be getting? 2 plus 2 plus 3. Isn't it? When your I value is 4, I'll be getting 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 4. When I value is 5, I'll be getting 2 plus 2 plus, sorry, ma, here should be 3, small error. Okay, 3 followed by 4 followed by 5. I guess you people got the logic behind it. So once you are solving it by step by step, we can able to find the logic behind it. So such a way it is going a long step. Let us assume it is going for m times. Okay, it is going for m times. What could be the equation here? 2 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. So this particular equation will be going till m times. So can you able to find some equation behind it? Except this 2, instead of just avoid this 2, instead of this 2, if you have 1, in place of 2, just assume if you have 1, what is the formula for it? What is the logic behind it? Come on, what is that?
N of n plus 1.
Okay, sum of natural numbers, right? So we can write the equation m into m plus 1 by 2. So this is nothing but how many times your m is going to be executed? M is going to be executed till m into m plus 1 by 2. This is the equation we have found out. Now going ahead with the termination condition. When this particular loop is going to be terminated? This is the termination condition we are supposed to write it. Guys, have a habit of forming equation by using termination condition, which will help you a lot. Okay. So when this particular loop will be terminated? Whenever your k value is greater than or equal to n value. Whenever your k value is greater than or equal to n value, either k value equals to n value or it goes beyond your n value, is going to terminate it. So we people know that, okay, how many times this particular k loop is going to be executed? It is going to be executed m into m plus 1 by 2 times. It's going to execute and this assign n. So what is the equation? Greater than or equals to n. So this is the equation. So whenever we are mentioning this greater than or equal to, have a habit of just removing this greater than and just assume equal to alone, which help us to form an equation. So here we are going to assume, here if at all you are solving this problem, what is the highest degree of polynomial we'll be getting? We'll be getting m square plus m divided by 2. I told you to assume, not to mention greater than, just assume equals to this for your assumption. Okay, here in case of derivation, majority of the places you are supposed to have an assumption, guys. So here, what is the highest degree of polynomial? M square is the highest degree of polynomial. So we are supposed to mention m square assign n. Is this clear? This step is very much important, guys, where the highest degree of polynomial should be considered. Normally, we'll be having some expression like x square plus x plus 2, where x square is the highest degree of polynomial which will be considered. Fine. Now, if I want to bring this element, this particular power this side, how can I bring it? What could be the m value? How can I bring this power? Square, if I'm bringing towards the right side, what could be the value? What could be the value of n? Sorry, m. Come on, normal mathematical equation. If I'm bringing this square towards the right side, what happened? Good, good, good. It is nothing but square root of n. I guess you people are following me. So it is nothing but square root of n. So here, what is your order? Your order is square root of n. It is so simple to calculate, isn't it? So the only thing is you people should trace this one. If at all you are tracing, it will be easy for us to find out. Okay, you people can able to form the equation. Okay, fine. Let me give one more scenario. We'll have still one more scenario for best case and worst case. Right now we are seeing a general scenarios, right? How to form the, how to find the order of it. Now let me show you a small example for your best case and worst case scenario. For the same program, I can be able to calculate the best case value as well as worst case value. So what is this best case and worst case? So we people are speaking about this order, right? Where this order square root of n, 1 log n, we are speaking about it, where all those things will be given as best case and worst case, where minimum number of iteration will be taken, minimum number of time taken will be given as order of 1, the maximum number of time taken will be given as exponent. So here we'll be speaking about best case and worst case, all those things. So let me give some scenario here. Why? M not equals to n. So let me apply condition here. Inside this, if your m value is greater than n value, okay, let me apply this condition. If at all my n value is greater than n value, I'm going to mention here m minus n. Okay, else I'll mention n assigned n minus m, a small scenario, guys. We are going to accept two values. So based on the input, we are going to do it. So let me have a sample input. Let me have two test cases. So in case of test case one, let us assume your m value is 6 and your n value is 3. This is one test case. So for this, what happened? Initially, I'll check m value is 6 and n value is 3. So what happened here for the first iteration? For the first iteration, what happened? Your m value will become as 3 and your n value will become as 3. Isn't it or not? What happened? M not equal to n. Condition is true. I'll check whether m greater than n, true. So m will be subtracted with 3. So both the element will be equal. For the next iteration, no more operation will be done. So here, what could be the complexity? Your complexity here is, this is a minimum number of minimum complexity, which is nothing but which is taken as order of 1. Isn't it? So whenever value is given like this, 6 and 3, only one iteration is taken. So here the minimum number of iteration is taken. Okay, minimum number of iteration is taken where the value here is order of 1. So this is your best case. This scenario is a simple example of your best case. In worst case, let us assume I'm giving m value as, what is the value I can assume? Okay, let it be 16. And let me assume n value as 2. Excuse me, guys. So if I'm assigning like this, so what happened? At the first iteration, I'll check whether m not equal to n, condition is 2. I'll come here. I'll check here, m not equals to m greater than n. My condition is 2. So what happened? My m value will be decremented n times. So if I'm decrementing n times, what happened? It will become as 14 and your n value remains as 2. For the next iteration, again, your condition is 2. M value is greater than n value. So again, it will be decremented and this value remains as 2. So this, what happened? This, for each and every iteration, this loop is going to execute and your m value is going to be decremented n times. So it will be 8 and it will be 2. And for next iteration, it will be of 6. I want you people to count how many iteration is taken. Can you people let me know how many iteration is taken? How many iteration is taken to terminate, guys? Just count it and let me know. You can ping me in the chat box. How many iteration is required here? Come on. For your second test case, how many iteration is required?
m by n.
N by n.
M by n.
M by n. Okay. Okay, good. So m by n is nothing but, for instead of n, we can take it as 2. It is a common expression. You can substitute with any value. Okay, m by n times. Here n is 2. So if you want to terminate this one, m by, where I need that m by 2 times the iteration is taken. So normally we know that here m by 2 times this loop is taken. So n by 2 times, in the sense, I'll omit this particular constant value. Okay, we'll omit this constant value. Normally we have an expression divided by n by 2 times the loop is executed, in the sense, I'll omit this constant value, where a maximum time this is taken is order of n. Guys, is this statement clear? This loop is going to be executed m by 2 times. So this value is a constant value. So I'll omit this constant value and take the remaining value, that is nothing but m times. So the terminology here is given as, the terminology given as m. So let us consider n. Whatever the variable it is, the common value, you can make it as n. So this loop will be executed n times. That is nothing but your worst case. Or I can name it as a maximum time the particular loop will be executed. Is it clear? Come on, guys.
Ma'am, when the while loop will stop, ma'am?
Whenever this particular m value not equals to n value.
Now also not equal, ma'am.
So one more iteration will be going.
16 and 2, it is not equal, ma'am. Then it will be stopping.
16 and 2 are not equal. Okay, just a minute. Just a minute, just a minute. Let me, I didn't notice it, just a minute.
M equal to n.
Okay, we should apply m equals to n, right? Okay, just a minute. 16 equals, no. What is the condition? Condition part is missing, right? 16 not equals to 2, conditions 2. Yeah, not equal is right. 16 not equals to, until the condition 2, when once both are equal, it will terminate. 16 not equals to condition true. This loop will be executed until your condition is true. Isn't it? So what happens here? 2 equals to 2. 2 not equals to, condition is false, your loop will be terminated.
Ma'am,
decrement.
Yes.
Decrement we didn't given, no, ma'am.
Here we are doing it manipulation. Here, m value and n value is changing inside your loop.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, yes, clear, we are doing as a manipulation realization. Okay, good.
Clear.
Okay, guys, one more small scenario for this best case and worst case. Then we can terminate this while loop. Okay, let me go ahead with for loop, one small program. Let us assume if my n value is greater than 5, I am going to print my n value. Else. Okay. Here, let me remove this parenthesis. Since you people are familiar with Python, let me remove this parenthesis. We'll write for Python itself. Okay, fine. Here, let me write a for loop. For I in range of, what is the range I can take till 0 to, I can assume 0 till n. And let us assume we people are printing here your I loop, I value. Okay, let us assume this is a scenario. In this scenario, we are going to calculate best case and worst case. The same way, let me take two test cases here. Test case 1. For test case 1, If at all my n value is less than 4, for example, if I give value 3, how many times your loop will be executed? How many times the if statement will be executed? Again, not audible. Guys, am I audible? The same issue, it is coming again. Come on, response to me. Am I audible, guys?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. What happens here, if at all my n value is given as less than 5, this particular will be executed very minimum time. That is nothing but a best case scenario, it will be executed. So in case of best case scenario, it will execute only one time. So it will never go for your else part. So it will execute order of 1. Okay. And next is, if at all my test case value is given as, if at all my test case value is given as n value which is greater than 5, for example, it is given as 10 or something. So how many times the values loop will be executed? If n value is given as 10, how many times it will be executed? Come on, answer me. If n value is given as, if your t2 value is given, if your input value is given as 10, how many times this loop is going to be executed?
N times.
N times, good. So the order is going to be order of n. So this is your best case and this is your worst case scenario, guys. So you can able to find the best case and worst case scenario for a algorithm. Whatever the algorithm it is, we can able to find the best case and worst case scenario. There is one more average case is there. So whenever you're finding average case, more or less average case will be nearer to your worst case. So it is not required to find the average cases. So this is how to calculate the complexity for a given scenario. So people are speaking about order of n, log n, all those things. What is this all about? We people might have some big question about this thing. These are the notation which we people are speaking, and this each and every notation is given a meaning to it. So let me explain you people before going to asymptotic notation. Let me explain about what are these notation all about and where this notation is useful. And then we can go ahead with asymptotic notation, how to separate this one. So just a minute, I'll scroll a little down. I'll type here. I don't know where does it goes. I'll copy paste here. So if I'm typing here in this session, it will take a large amount of time. So there is a reason I typed already. Okay. So far we people are seeing some degree, right? Order we are seeing it. These are the degree people might have came across. The lowest one, which is nothing, the most effective one is nothing but order of 1. This is the most efficient one. Order of 1 is the most efficient one and which executes faster. So none of the algorithm here, none of the complexity is faster as much of order of 1. Okay, so if you take some example, what are the algorithm that can, so what happens here whenever you're getting some constant value. So three times the particular, three statements are there. So once you're getting three values, you'll be getting constant values. For example, the first case, I guess you people could remember swapping of two numbers by using for loop, I did, right? But normally we did, right? Swapping of two numbers. So which follows constant. So there are three statements will be executed only once. Those cases comes under constant. So if at all you're taking some example, you can check, you can have a normal program accepting input and displaying it without using loop. Without using loop, let us assume 4 or 5 lines are there and these 5 lines is going to be executed. All those things comes under constant. Guys, are you people clear with what are the example for constant? Normal input output comes under constant. And apart from the finding odd numbers, determining numbers odd or even, I can give some example for this one. You can take example as finding odd or even. Okay. And swapping of numbers. Swapping of two numbers, just accepting input, assigning, accepting input and displaying, all those things comes under this constant. Okay, we'll have constant notation. So in spite of calculating, you can able to find out just if the scenario is like this, we'll be getting output as order of 1. And the next is will be we might have got as log of log n, which is nothing but double logarithmic. So this double logarithmic is nothing but which is next faster to your constant value. This is the first one which is so faster up. The next one is the ranking two element is double logarithmic. So in case of double logarithmic, we can take some examples. What are the examples? I was not sure you people might have came across this interpolation search. Normal search, you know what? And there is one element called interpolation search for searching algorithm. And apart from this, guys, have you came across tree graph data structure? Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
Have you came across? No. Okay, okay, fine. So in case of, we'll be naming as a Tango tree algorithm and all those things. Those places you'll be having this double logarithmic algorithm will be implemented, which is faster next to constant value. So our next is square root function. Just now I told you a small example for square root, right? And next preference will be given for your square root functions. For square root functions, guys, you should know that what is the example for each and everything. It is very much important. And next is for square root, we can consider, I guess you people might have came across binary search, isn't it? Linear search, binary search. Yes or no? Binary search? No? Come on, respond something. Yes, no. No, ma'am. Okay, okay, okay. Fibonacci series, at least Fibonacci series. Fibonacci series. Right? Okay. Fibonacci. Oh, good, good. So all those things, calculating Fibonacci number, binary search. Okay, a simple calculation of searching a name from the phone book manually, all those things comes under square root. So far we have seen what is constant, what is double logarithmic, and next is square root. So the first preference is given for constant, and next is double logarithmic, and next faster will be square root function. Okay, just a minute, guys. Did I think so? I left something. It's not just guys. Small confusion, guys. Just a minute. Square root. This is for logarithmic. This is not an example for square root. Logarithmic, guys. Logarithmic is nothing but binary search and Fibonacci series. Okay. So then, what about the square root function? What are the things comes under square root function? So for square root function, we'll have some example. So without knowledge about data structure, what is the example should I give? Have you heard about this prime number factorization, guys? Prime number factorization. Yes, ma'am, in C programming. Okay, 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 okay. Prime number factorization, have you heard about it? Prime factorization. Just now we have seen about prime numbers. Could you remember square root of time, the particular loop will be executed. The last class you have seen it. Could you remember this one? The last class example I have given you guys, prime number. Come on, response to me. We have seen about this prime number. Could you remember? Prime number executing square root of times. This example can be taken for a square root. Okay. So far we have seen what is constant, double logarithmic, logarithmic, and square root. And next is linear. Okay. And next is we are going to see with the linear. In case of linear, we can say with a normal array concept, we are executing in a linear manner. Traversing an array in a linear manner, one after other can be considered here. Apart from this, I can consider example. If at all you people know linked list, okay. I guess you people are not aware about this data structure, right? So what is the example I can give? Checking palindrome. I guess you people came across the terminology called palindrome. Whatever the order you are reading the particular string, it will say it is a palindrome or not. For example, real, Malayalam, all those things comes under palindrome. So these checking palindrome is a simple example of linear, where one after other I'm checking. First character, next character, next character. All those things comes under linear search. And apart from this, we can give some example comparing two strings. We'll consider two strings. We'll compare character by character, which particular string is greater. Okay, all those things comes under linear. And next is log linear. So we are computer till linear, and we are going to see with log linear. Guys, we might have came across the notation. Just I'm giving some example for each and every notation, guys. Okay. And next is log linear. In case of log linear, we might have came across different type of searching algorithm. Sorry, sorting algorithm. What are the sorting algorithm you people has came across? Can you people let me know? Sorting is nothing but arranging data in an order. So there are certain different types of algorithms are there. Have you heard about it? Yes. What are those? What are those algorithms? Insertion sort. Okay, good. Guys, others, you can answer me. Whatever the sorting is there, if at all you know, you can answer me, guys. Only one answer I got from Bharat. What about others were quiet? Don't you hear about sorting algorithms? Guys, what happened? Have you heard? Tell me yes or no, something. Give me some answers, guys. Response. Yeah, good. So bubble shot, quick shot, good. Okay. Guys, at least try to find it. Search and find it. You people are so quiet. Which is nothing but arranging a data can be done in different type of sorting. Okay. Merge sort, quick sort, heap sort, many things are there. Among those sorting algorithm, where your merge sort is the most efficient one compared to all the sorting algorithm, which we'll be seeing in the forthcoming session. Don't worry if at all you don't know about it. Okay. Merge sort, heap sort, okay, quick sort. All those algorithm comes under log linear. It will take only log linear. Clear with it? It'll take only log linear. And next is quadratic. So in case of quadratic in the sense, it will take three for loops more than that. It comes under quadratic. In case of quadratic, the other sorting algorithm we can take as an example, which is nothing but bubble sort. Okay, insertion sort. And your selection sort. These are the simple example of your quadratic notation. And apart from this, we can take cubic. Guys, just I'm keep on saying this one. Don't be worried about this. Just I'm speaking about the notation. I'm giving some example for you. Just I'm giving you a known example. Everyone knows about this example, I guess. Okay, just I'm relating with the example, whatever you know. In case of cubic, this is based on your complete example of data structure, which is nothing but Folliot-Warshall algorithm. This is the only example I can say. No, I can't ever relate this example with C programming, so no other way you're supposed to learn this one. Okay, this is the algorithm, which is a simple example for cubic. Okay, and apart from this, what is left over? Cubic is done, exponent and factorial is left over. So speaking about the factorial, so exponent. exponential, I can take simple example of Fibonacci, this one, recursion function. All the recursion function will go ahead with this exponential. Okay, all the recursion functions comes under the example of this one. That is the reason this recursion function will never advise, it is not advisable to use it. It will take more amount of times, guys, compared to normal one. Recursion function will take more amount of time. Let us assume by using recursive method, you're going to generate this Fibonacci series. You're going to generate Fibonacci series in a recursive method, which is not advisable. Now, mostly whenever people are going to implement recursive, it will take a lot of time. Normally, I'll you know, in case of normal, if you're going to write competitive exam, there just avoid recursion. The reason is, whenever you're doing recursion, it will take your stack memory, it will cause a stack overflow. Okay. It is not a best practice to use recursion. So that is the reason you can able to find what is the order of recursion function. It is exponential. Okay. The last one, which is the worst case, is given for factorial. Factorial is given as the worst case. This is the overall, the worst case. Lowest preference is given. Here, the example, what I can give is, have you came across this permutation and combination? In any one of your hacker rank question, permutations, this terminology, permutation, combination, having different combination of this element, all those things comes under factorial. And apart from this, have you came across brute force algorithm? Or salesperson algorithm. These are the common problems which is most frequently used in competitive exams, guys. Brute force, or I can name it as a salesman problem. When you're searching salesman problem itself, we'll be getting a question. These questions are most commonly used. A queen problem, salesman problem, brute force algorithm. All those things comes under this factorial. Guys, these are the different notation, and I given small example for each and every notation. The order which is given the higher preferences, constant will be given higher preference, and followed by the remaining one by one will be given next. The worst case is nothing but your factorial. Is it clear so far? Shall we go ahead with asymptotic notation? If at all I'm going fast, if people can let me know. Is this clear so far? Come on. Guys, respond me. Okay, fine. Good. And now, I given this particular notation, right? So if at all you're going to have this in an asymptotic notation. So we are speaking about what is log n, what is square root of n, and we are speaking about what else we have spoke about, square root of n, log n, then n square, n cube, all those things we spoke about, right? All those things are notation, common notation, and there is some asymptotic notation are there, which is nothing but where this calculation has to be mentioned by using asymptotic notation. So I'll let you know what is asymptotic notation, what are the asymptotic notations are there. So speaking about the asymptotic notation, so we are having three elements, that is nothing but big O. The first one is big O notation. Big O notation. And next is omega. Okay, and next is theta. These are the three type of notation. So once you are considering omega, this big O is considered to be the upper bound of your notation. I'll let you know what is upper bound, guys. Just give me a second. After completing this topic, this one, I'll let you know. And omega is your lower bound. Okay. And theta, when I'm speaking about this theta, this is the average bound. We are speaking about this worst case, best case, right? So the best case scenario, we'll be speaking about the lower bound. and the worst case scenario we'll be speaking about the upper bound, and this theta is the average case scenario. Okay, now we have seen about this expression, right? This expression will be mentioned in this manner. You can mention in a sequence. I told you the first preference is given for 1, and next is log n, and next is we can mention as square root of n, and next preference is given for n, and next preference might be n log n, and next preference might be n power of 2, and next preference might be n power of 3. The sequence is increasing, guys. This is your lower bound. This is the best case. I told you that this lower bound is your best case and the upper bound will be the worst case. Just I'm stacking the relation whatever we are seeing so far, guys, just one after other, just I'm stacking. Okay, and after this you can mention 2 power of n, and followed by 3 power of n, then we can have it goes till the worst case is nothing but factorial n power of n. Okay, this is the notation, just a common notation I have given for calculating time complexity. We have seen these notation. So now we are going to find the asymptotic notation. So the asymptotic notation is nothing but where the lower bound is given with the initial value, where the upper bound is given with the big O notation, which is nothing but the worst case scenario, and this average case scenario will lies between any one of this range. Is this clear so far? Shall we go ahead with the calculation? Come on, answer me. Guys, respond to me. Is it clear so far? Shall we proceed to the next one? How to calculate this asymptotic notation?
Clear, ma'am.
Okay, fine. And next is the first, let us have a clarification about what is big O notation and how to calculate it. So for big O notation, there is some mathematics. All this big O, omega, theta, okay, all those things as a math, all those things is depends upon mathematical equation. So the no other way, we people are supposed to have some mathematical equation. First let me write this mathematical equation, then let me explain you what is that. Okay, the function f of n assigned O of g of n. Guys, this is a predefined mathematical notation. I didn't write anything as my own. Okay, so this is an equation they'll be giving here. The condition is, I'll explain you what is this. If there exists positive constant C and C naught, and here such that f of n is less than or equals to c into g of n, there exists, whether n is greater than or equals to n naught. Guys, this is a mathematical equation which has been given for big O, okay, which is nothing but f, the function f of n equals to big O of g of n, if there exists positive constant c and c naught such that f of n is less than or equal to c into g of n, there exists n greater than n naught. So let us have some example, then we can substitute with this equation. Don't be worried about this equation is not clear. Once I relate this with the example, it will be very clear, guys. Just let us take a small example. So far we are having evaluating the function, right? We are taking a loop and we are evaluating it, right? So let me give a small example of it. Let us consider some equation like this, where f of n, and this f of n, let us assume we got the expression like this. This is nothing but, guys, don't be confused, this expression is nothing but the expression which we formed as a resultant of each and every evolution. Like this, we have formed it, right? We are forming some expression here. Like this, I'm taking some function like this, and I'm going to calculate asymptotic notation. Directly we did here as a manual process. Here I will teach you people how to learn as an asymptotic notation how to solve this one. Is it clear? Clear with the notation? I have taken this notation from there. Shall we proceed till this, sorry people, clear?
Yeah.
Yes.
N greater than or equal to N naught. What is N naught, ma'am?
N naught is just a notation. This is an equation notation, guys. Then relate, if they will be mentioning some diagrammatic, all those things, it will be a huge concept. Just assume that they're mentioning diagrammatic representation, they'll mention one graph as C and one graph as G, and where the lower bound will be given as N and upper bound will be given as C naught. If I'm going to the particular concept, it will be a huge one. So just assume there is an element called N naught. I'll explain you at the end of the example. Okay, just assume,
okay,
right now, just assume it, okay?
Okay.
So now we people are going to evaluate it. So what is the expression they are taken? Where? This is the expression they are taken. The expression taken is f of n less than or equal to c into g of n. So we people know that what is f of n. Here the f of n taken is, this is the expression we are taken as f of n, 2n plus n. This is the expression which you have taken. So what you are supposed to do, I should write some element which is nothing but to equate this one. C into g of n has to be written. And as you know, what is g and what is c and what is g. So we people can roughly assume that any value which is greater than this particular 2n can be assumed as value. Which is nothing but reason what I have given is f of n less than or equal to c into g of n. This equation should be less. So we can assume some value for it. I'll give you three different ways for solving this one, guys. This is the first one. So we people can assume any value which is greater than your 2n. The reason is I have taken greater than your 2n. That is nothing but your f of n value. Here the 2n is the greater value. So I can consider any value. I can mention 10n or 3n, 4n, 5n, anything can be considered. Just you are going to assume it. Any value greater than your 2n can be assumed here. So by taking here, where this particular 10 is here, according to the statement, where 10 is treated as your c value and this n is treated as your g of n value. Okay, now your equation has been satisfied. Keeping this equation has been satisfied. So what is the higher degree of polynomial here? The higher degree of polynomial is taken as order of n. I'll give you one more way of solving this question, guys. Just a minute. I'll give you other approach. So why to assume like this? We people might have having a confusion. So why should I assume less than or equal to 10? Can't we use anything else? Yes, it can be done. So the value, the note I given you this sequence, right? So this is your lower bound. Right now, this are only three notation: upper bound, lower bound, and average bound. For this particular scenario, you can take a value n. From n, any value can be taken for the expression. So minimum will take n value. What you can do is take the same expression and multiply n with all the numbers. You can able to multiply n with all the numbers. So if you are multiplying n with all the numbers, you will be getting an equation 2n plus 3n. Either you can assume directly or you can take this expression. If at all it is, if you feel that it's very hard for me to assume, imagine you can take the expression and I can have all the values with n, which is nothing but this equation will be greater than the f of n equation. Now you can able to form the equation that is nothing but 2n. Guys, here majority of a thing is taken only as an assumption. Don't try to relate with anything. You'll be confused. So you'll be getting 5n. 5n is greater than this equation. Again, which leads to the same result. Okay. Now, I have told you that I can take any value within this range. So here, or I told you that, right? This is the equation for this particular scenario. I told you that I can take any value. So within this range, where this particular n is considered to be a lower bound. So a value from n, any value can be multiplied along with the value for this equation. So now you people might have a doubt. So I'm having an expression like this. I'm having expression 2n plus 3. Can I multiply instead of n? You people might have a doubt. Can I multiply n squared or log n? Yes, that is advisable. You can multiply 2n square plus 3n. Guys, is this equation clear for you people? Either you can multiply any number. Right now, the given highest degree is n. So from n till your factorial, any number can be multiplied to find the order of it. So if at all you're multiplying, what happened? I'll get my order of degree here as this equation will be like this, right? Guys, since power notation is not easy to write in this notepad, just I'm mentioning by using cap symbol here, just try to understand it. So what happened? 2 plus 3, I'll get 5n power, so it should be 2, right? 2. So I'll get this equation as my answer. So for this equation, your order will not be same. So you'll be getting the order in this way, order of n square. Order of n square. So this way also I can write it, but the best way is nothing but this gives you the best way. After n, you can able to have any value towards its upper bound can be multiplied, and you can able to find the theta by using notation, big O notation. You can give like this. Is it clear, guys? Come on. I given as initially I taught you people by looking at the expression how to find it out it. So once you are finding out, you can able to find out whether it is a n or log n or square root of n. If at all I want to implement by using big O notation, you should know how this function is executing. Either you can assume like this and you can able to calculate it, or you can able to you can take the expression and multiply n with all the values, where n will be applied for all the values in the expression. You can able to find it and you can able to find the notation of it. And apart from this, you can take any value within this range. Not only n can be multiplied along with it, you can take any value after n till the upper bound, any value can be taken. So if you are taking any value, based on that you'll be getting your order. And it is advisable to have the exact value. The reason is all those things is based on your complexity. It is advisable to have an exact one. Till this, are you clear with this big O notation, ma? Do you have any doubt in it? Come on. Clear. Okay. And next is omega. Yes? Yes, yes.
Directly the expression will become the order of that expression, no?
Just we are assuming it, not to equate it. Which one are you asking? You're assuming it. This is the equation. This is the, as per the big one notation, this is the statement they are given. We are substituting and we are assuming it. We are taking f of n. We know that the f of n. So we are forming this c of n based on this f of n.
That now, ma'am.
Okay.
We are multiplying this expressions, ma'am.
Which one? The last one. You are speaking about the last one?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
From that, how we derived order of S, ma'am.
N power 2, you are asking, right?
Yes.
Okay. Guys, this is nothing. Previously, what you are doing, since it is n higher degree of polynomial, I am multiplying n with all the values and finding this equation. So this n is nothing but I have given some sequence right here. Could you can notice here. In this sequence, n lies at this position. So what is the condition here? So n should be less than this equation, right? N should be less than the equation, whatever you are forming. So n I'm having, if when the expression n will be less than, if at all, any one of the combination I'm getting, this I'll get any expression which is less than or equal to n. For example, let us assume I'm taking a value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I say some condition, less than, where your x value is less than or equals to, if I say this one, x value is less than or equals to 3. What is the range we'll take? Starting from 3 to 5, isn't it? Yes or no? Yes or no? Guys, are you following me? If I take like this, we'll take values from 3 to 5. Okay. Now, what is the number they are given? The value here we are going to take is f of n. F of n, the higher degree is n. So, starting from n, I can take any value to the upper bound. So, our equation here is less than or equal to c of n. So, the c into g of n can be formed with any one of the notation what is there, whatever it is there. So normally I have done with this one, so I can, for your understanding, I have taken this n square and I'm multiplying with the expression whatever it is there. So I'll take, instead of multiplying n with it, I'm multiplying n square, 2 into n square plus 3 into n square. Okay, so if I'm adding these two, I'll get 5 n square. Comparing to the higher degree of polynomial with this expression, the higher degree is n square, could be a order of it. Even for this expression, I'll get this n square as answer, but this is the worst case. The best case will be order of n. Is it clear now?
Clear, ma'am.
Nikhila, what about you? Is that clear? This is just an assumption. And here, for your, instead of assume, you can able to multiply and check it. Apart from this, you can take any value from n to n power n. The reason is your f of n is less than or equal to c into g of n. Okay, this is all about your big O notation. And the next one is we people are going to see with omega notation. Guys, since it is not easy to draw here, omega will be like this. I guess you people could remember the omega notation. Okay, here that's a symbolic notation, guys, omega. In case of omega notation, I'm going to have the same, some mathematical equation is there. Let me copy paste here. Small changes is there. For this, instead of this O, I'll mention this theta, this one, omega symbol. I'm writing as a statement, guys. Just I have a habit of writing as a symbolic notation here. Symbolic is nothing but omega symbol. Okay. Here, what is this condition? The function f of n is equals to omega of g of n if there exists constant value. Guys, just right now, just assume this n of o and this c of o. Right now, it is not required. Since you are drawing graph, this notation can be mentioned. Here I'm not drawing any gap, just assume this one as a mathematical. Here, instead of this less than or equal to, their function will be greater than or equal to. Those are small changes between your omega and big O. Okay, there we'll be mentioning a function less than or equal to can be taken. Here the function greater than or equal to will be taken. And this is the condition we are supposed to consider, same condition. The only symbol is modifying. Now, what you're supposed to, let me take the same example here. The same example. So it'll be easy for you to understand. Okay. Correlate with this omega with this big O. So here, instead of this less than, I'll have greater than. Okay, let me remove this one. So now how we people are going to solve this one? This is the next scenario. So let me copy paste this also, guys. So I'll take this expression, same example, 2 of n, 2n plus 3, greater than or equals to, here this value should be this expression. This expression should be, this expression, the expression at your left hand side should be greater than this expression. So what can be the maximum value of n? It can be of 1. Let me assume as 1. So here the assumption is any value which is less than 2n should be assumed. Here it is greater than and it is 2n. The higher degree is 2n. So any value less than 2n can be assumed here. Is that clear, guys? Are you following? Again, you're going to get here the answer of f of n as you'll be getting omega of n. Sorry, guys, typo error. Instead of big O, I'll make use of omega. Is this clear? Guys, while I mentioned omega of n, the highest degree of polynomial is n. Very simple calculation. Okay, and next one is, guys, if at all you find out, just stop me there itself. It is very simple. Instead of less than, I'm putting greater than, I'm making that this expression should be greater. So any value less than this can be considered. So now we people might be having doubt, what is the upper range and what is the lower range? So now I'll take this value. Now I'll take this value. So any value less than n can be considered. So you people might have a doubt. Can I take multiple of log n? Yes, that is also possible as we do previously. 1 into log n. So you'll be getting answer as log n. Any value less than it. I have taken the minimum value as 1. The most minimum value I have taken as 1. Clear? So here, this is in case of theta. Here, your lower bound value will be taken. So whenever you are taking with omega, what happened? The upper bound, the maximum upper bound value can be taken here. In case of, sorry, ma, in case of big O, a maximum upper bound value can be taken. In case of omega, the maximum lower bound value can be taken. And next is, we are going to see with theta notation. Guys, if at all you are learning somewhere, just it'll be, look, it looks like a very vague subject, but it is very easy to understand. Once you are clear with it, There is no big difference between calculation of function and putting the particular function in notation. It is very simple. You should know what this mathematical notation, mathematical equation should be known to you. That's it. Once you know mathematical equation, the same value can be implemented by using big O or omega or theta. Here there is no rule that I should find only the complexity by using omega or theta or big O. You can use any one else, whichever you are convenient with it. So here, what is the condition? The same one. I'm going to copy paste here. You can notice I didn't make much difference. Wherever I find, guys, here omega has to be mentioned. So theta has to be mentioned. Theta, normally in case of mathematics, you'll be using theta symbol. Whereas zero will be given with one cross inside it. There's a theta. Constant here. Your equation is C1. C2 and followed by your number. And here, this equation is going to change a little, guys. So the equation, what you'll be get is C1 into G of n. Just give me a second, let me type it. C1 into g of n less than or equals to f of n, and this f of n is less than or equal to c2 of f of n. So this is the equation we are supposed to substitute for theta notation. So we'll see to it what is that all about. Okay. So let me remove this, it is not required. So here also, I'm going to make use of the same example. I'm not going to use different example, guys. I'm going to make use of same example for your understanding. So it will be easy for you to understand. That's the reason I'm making use of same example for three notations also. So I take make it, made use of same example, and here, I'll substitute this. See, I'll put this syntax here, guys. It will make use of, it will be easy for us to substitute then and there. Okay. So what is our f of n? Our f of n value is 2n plus 3 is the f of n value. Okay. So any value which is nothing but here we people are speaking about, here what is the expression they are speaking about? They are speaking about omega. And here what is the expression they are speaking about? There's any expression that they are speaking about is big O. Is that clear, guys? Big O notation they are speaking about here, and here those people are speaking about this omega notation. Now let us substitute this omega notation. What can be done? Someone, Michael is unmuted. So here omega notation, what is the minimum value we can take? The minimum value what you are taken is 1 into n can be taken. So let me mention 1 into n. Okay, this is the minimum value. So what is the maximum value we are taken? What is the maximum value I calculated? We can make use of 2n plus n, that is nothing but we can take as 5n as your value. So this is the maximum bound of value. Okay, according to this theta, I told you that this theta is the average case where your big O is your upper bound and your this one omega is your lower bound and theta is the average case. So now according to this equation, you could notice that this C1 is 1 and Gn is n, f of n is the equation, C2 is 5 and G of n is n. So when this G of n and G of n is equal, I can able to find the equation. So what is the highest degree of polynomial here? Your highest degree of polynomial is n. So I can make use of f of n as sign. Here I should make use of theta symbol, guys, instead of mentioning other theta of n. Okay. Now we people might have a doubt. I'm having a this big expression in case of this big O and this omega, I use some other values. I have taken a range of value. Right now, I know that my exact point is this. My exact point is this. Now, can we make use of this lower bound and upper bound? And can I mention the expression by using square root of log? It is not, this is not advisable. So, in case of theta, the exact point only can be taken. Apart from this, nothing can be taken. Guys, is that clear? For in case of theta, I can't able to go with upper bound or lower bound. The exact value only can be taken for your theta. In case of big O and omega, I can take with the value with upper bound, any one of the value and value from the lower bound. Theta, that is not possible. Nagaraju, what happened? Okay, you mentioned 2n. Okay, good. Till this, are you people clear, guys? What is the notation? Asymptotic notation available? Come on, answer me. It is very simple, guys. It seems to be a big scenario base, but it is very simple. Nothing is inside it. Others, what happened? Everyone is quiet. Only Nikila is answering. Others went to saturation point. Okay, clear. Okay. Good. Okay, guys. Now, we'll take some scenario and we can work with it. Let us assume we want to perform some search operation. I guess everyone knows about search operation. Searching an element in array. Okay. So let us assume there is a sequence of value. Right now, we people, in case of search, there are different types of searches there. Now, we people are going to perform linear search. In case of linear search, let us assume there is a sequence of value. Either you can consider as an array or a list, whatever it is, it's up to you. Okay. So let us assume there is a sequence of value like 8, 6, 12, we can say take some value, 12, 5, 9, 7, 10, 4, 3, what else I can take, 16, 18, I think it's sufficient. And next, we can consider various cases where whenever you're seeing with the program, I can able to find best case, worst case scenario. Okay, just now we are seeing, right, your best case, worst case and average case. Worst case and followed by average case. So we are going to see with these three scenarios. So let me take few test cases here. So let me take a test case one. In test case one, if at all the number to be searched is 8, so how many iteration does it required here, guys? If the number to be searched, how many iteration is that required? Come on, answer me. Are you people there? Respond me.
One.
Single iteration, good. One iteration is required. So your order is given with O of one. Guys, it is not required. It is not mean that you should mention only by using big O. You can mention by using theta or omega. It's up to you. Okay, where this O, big O is commonly used. Everyone, you can, everywhere you can notice that it is mentioning as big O notation. Okay, you can make use of any one of a notation, whatever you are familiar with it or you're comfortable with it. Okay, and let me give some other test case here. Test case, and here let us assume the number to be searched is 18. What could be the scenario here? What could be the order of it? How many times the loop has to be executed, guys? This is a sequential search. N times. Ten. Good. Good. Ten. Good. 10 times here. Again, 10 value. So 10 times. So based on your N value, it has to be executed. If at all I given 30 as my value. Now how many times will you execute? If I give 30 as my value, how many times? Again, 10 times. Good. So if the value is present at the last position, or if the value is present at here, not present. If it is present or not present, whatever it is going to execute n times. So this is a scenario here for this worst case. So this is your best case scenario, and this is your worst case scenario. So let me put here, it will be easy for you to understand. So this is your worst case scenario. And as I told you that more or less your average case would be similar to your worst case only. So we'll calculate for one program. It will be, once you're calculating for a single program, it is not required to calculate the average case for all the programs. Okay, I'll show you how to calculate this average cases.
Ma'am?
Yes?
For n equals to 30, how many times it will repeat, ma'am?
It'll search to the end of element. Once you're going to the end of the loop only, I can able to find whether the value is there or not. Until unless I doesn't know whether the value is present or not. The reason is it will check whether the particular value might be present at the end of my list or array. So again, it has to go till n times. Is it clear? Is it clear? You want me to repeat again?
It will read it.
Not 30 times. How many numbers are there? 3, 6, 9, 10. So 10 times will be executed. At the 10th iteration only, it can able to determine that whether 30 is there or not.
Okay, ma'am. Clear.
Okay. In case of average case will have one equation like this, which is nothing but all possible cases divided by number of cases. Okay, this is the equation we'll be using simply not to find the average case. Here, how many possible cases are there? So here, as I told you that here n possible cases are there. It might have one case or two case or three case. It can have n cases here. Okay, so these are all possible cases, and number of cases to the maximum is n. Okay, so as we derive, we know that this is nothing but sum of natural numbers. We can able to derive by n into n plus 1 by 2 as your equation divided by n. So we people can able to cancel this particular n value with this n value. So what happened at the end, you'll be getting equation as solved. This is a normal mathematical solving equation, guys. Once you are dividing it, you'll be getting value n plus 1 by 2 as your answer. At the end, removing all the constant, again, you'll get the value n as your answer. So here at the end, what is the worst case we are getting? At the end, again, worst case, you're going to get. So average case, you're going to get the answer of your worst case. Is this clear? This is the reason I told you that more or less your worst case and your average case is going to be a same value. Come on, respond me. Is it clear how to find a average case, best case and worst case, and how to implement this notation? Yes, okay, good. Okay, guys, we are completed till this, and next is we people are going to start with recursion. If at all you have any doubt on it, you can let me know.
And once explain average case.
Average case, okay, I'll explain again. So average case can be determined by using all possible cases divided by number of cases. This is how your average case can be determined. So all possible cases, in the sense, the possible case is nothing but it can, the element can be, might be at the first position, or the element whatever you're searching might be a second position, third position, or it can be of nth position. So it can be of any position. So the possible cases can be given as 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus till n divided by number of cases. What is the number of cases I'll be having? I'll have n number of cases will be having. So this is the equation I have formed for the average case. So if we know that this is the formula for natural numbers, so let me substitute natural numbers n into n plus 1 by 2 divided by n. So if you are evaluating this one, this particular n and this n and this n will be get cancelled. The remaining values will be n plus 1 by 2. So removing the constant value at the n, you'll be getting n as your answer, which is nothing but you'll be mentioning O of n as your answer. This result will be same as your worst case. Clear?
N plus 1 we will get no more. If we remove the constant.
Remove here. N constants will be removed here. The highest degree of polynomial will be taken as your output.
Okay, ma'am. Clear, ma'am.
Okay. And next is, we people are going to see with recursion function. What is recursion? Recursive function or recursion function, whatever you are familiar with, you can mention. What is that, ma? Recursive? Come on. Recursive. The function call itself, good. Reoccurring in a condition, good. Reoccurring of a condition, okay. Normally, when I are defining a function, the function will be called only once, or based on the loop, the function will be called. Here, this recursion function is nothing but I'm going to make a function to call by itself n number of times. For example, let me take a small scenario for recursion function. So we'll be defining def followed by let a function. I guess you people, we have seen about how to declare a function, right? Okay. Let me have a function which receives the n value. And here, let me write a if condition. If at all my n is greater than 0, I will return n value. We can print it, why to return? I'll reprint it. Okay, I'll have small scenario where I'll print it. And after this, what I'm going to do is I'm going to call the function again, my test of n minus 1. Guys, a small program, guys, here. I didn't make much complex here. Very simple. If at all, I'm drawing tracing tree of it. Tracing tree is nothing but just I'm going to trace this particular recursion function. Either it is known as tracing tree or it is also known as recursive tree. So if it is of paint, it will be easy to understand. Paint will draw a picture of it. We can understand it. So let me draw a recursive tree here. Just a minute, guys. So let us draw a tracing tree here. So initially, let us assume this function is called with the value test of 3. If the function is called with the test of 3, what happened? Initially, n value will be passed as 3. So let us assume here I'm going to call this function as test of 3. So if I'm calling, what happened? What will be a n value? Your n value passed is 3, and it will come here where n value passed is 3. Just listen here, guys. N value passed is 3. I'll check whether n is greater than 0. Yes. So what happened? It will be 3 will be printed, and followed by the function will be called again, which is nothing but we are test will be passed with the value 2, and again this function will be called. Again, what happened? This will print a value 2 in your output. Again, this will call the function again test of 1. Okay, again, what happened? Yeah, one guys, just I'm tracing this program how this will be executed. First 2, 3 will be printed, again it will be called with n minus 1. So test of 2 will be called again, it goes back again. Okay, and again 2 will be passed, so 2 printed, again 1 will be, 2 minus 1, 1 will be passed again. So test of 0, test of 0 will be called again. So this is how your recursive tree we are supposed to draw it, guys. Okay, now listen carefully. So how many times this function is called? So at the last time when test of 0 is passed, when n value is 0, your this particular function is never be executed. Okay, it will just come out of it and the data in your stack is going to be printed. So how many times your function call is made? Your function call is made one time here, and one more function call is made here. This is your second function call, again one more time. Okay, and here this function call is along with your third time. So at the fourth time it is going to break, there no more iteration is going to happen. So overall, how many function call is going to happen? So as a overall, you'll be having 3 function calls. It's very hard to switch. Okay. As a overall, you'll be having 3 function calls. This is all about your function calls. Again, this function call is a constant value. Guys, I guess you people could understand what is recursion function. I'm trying to call a function again. If at all required, I'll take a small program, I'll put in a stack and I'll show you how does this executes. Okay, and right now we people are going to calculate the complexity of it. So 1 time, 2 time, 3 and 4. Just a minute, is it 3 or 4? 4 times, right? The last one also the function call is made and it is executed. So 4 times it is made. So how 4 is nothing but, so what is your f of n here? Your f of n is the statements inside this particular loop has been executed. Here is your function call is made as n plus 1 time the function call is made. At the last time when the statement is executed, it is going to be terminated. So how many times the statement inside this particular loop is going to be executed? N plus 1 time. If at all your n value is 3, this particular value will be executed 4 times, 5 in the sense 6 times, 6 in the sense 7 times, one more than the value what you have passed. So this is nothing but your f of n. So what is the order you're getting? Once for a recursion expression, you'll be getting order of n. Is this clear, guys? How to calculate for recursion expression? Answer me. Yes, okay, good. Okay, next we'll go ahead with how to write this recursion function. Okay, we'll see how to write this recursion function. So far we have seen with the overall concept, what is recursion, how to find the time complexity. Now we'll go ahead with the recursion. Guys, will you people write logic for recursion for a factorial of a given number? Will you people just ping me the factorial? It is so simple, right? Factorial of a given number, calculating by using recursion. Everyone knows it, I guess. Isn't it or not? Yes, right? Will you people write it? I'll explain you the small example. Just try it out soon. We'll see with some other new example. I'll give you 2 or 3 minutes of time, just hardly 3 lines of code, right? Just try it out. Come on. Whenever you are using recursion, the data is stored in your stack, guys. It is stored in your stack and it will be executed. Come on soon, just 3 lines of code, right? Three lines of code, not more than that for case of recursion of function. Some typo error is there. Factorial. What happened? Guys, we are okay. We are done with this calculation of this analysis of algorithm has been completed. Now we are seeing how to calculate, how to write this recursion program. Okay, div function. Okay, fine. In fact. What is the termination condition, Ma? You didn't mention termination condition. Have you mentioned termination? B5. Does he know your name? CB5. If guys, make sure that there should be some termination condition when the loop should be terminated. Here, just I give an example here. Termination condition should be there when the loop will be terminated. If at all there is no termination, it will go with infinite loop. So make sure that whenever you are writing program by using recursion, termination should be there. Okay, good, Sanita, good. What about others? What about others? Others were so quiet. Okay, let us do here. Okay, Nagraj is saying. Good, Nagraj, good. So we'll do here once. So instead of typing and wasting time, let me copy paste the code whatever your friends have sent. Okay. Yeah, condition, termination condition. Yes, that's right. If at all you're including termination condition, that's right. Here I can apply a condition if your n value equals to 0. Okay, look at here once, guys. We'll see how this particular program recursion function is working. We should understand how it is working. Okay, so here this particular recursion function is going to make use of your stack memory. Speaking about the memory, we are having two types of memory, stack and heap memory is there. So whenever you're speaking about the stack memory, this case of recursion, it makes use of stack memory, guys. So a heap memory will be dynamic memory allocation, all those things takes care of heap memory. Heap memory is required here mainly for recursion. It occupies stack memory. I'll let you know why the stack memory is required. Initially, what happened? Let us assume this scenario. What I am doing is we are calling this function called fact. And let me first explain what I'm doing. What we are doing here is there is a function called fact. Until my n value reaches 1 or 0, I'm going to apply a condition here. If at all my n value is equals to 1 or 0, I'll return n value. Else, again, I'll call my fact function by multiplying n into n minus 1. This is the scenario we have mentioned here. Now, let us go ahead further. Initially, what you're doing is you're going to pass your fact function with a value 5. So this is passed here. So what happened? The value 5 is passed. I'll check with my condition whether my n value is equals to 1 or 0. Your condition fails. So automatically come to the else part. And here right now n value is 5. So 5 into fact of 5 minus 1, which is nothing but 4 will be called. Clear with this thing. So again, the same function is called again with the value fact of 4. Okay, so since I told you this is a stack memory, it has to be kept above to it. Normally, let us assume you're going to stack the books in your classroom. What will be doing? The first person who keeps the books will be at the bottom. The next person who keeps the book above to it will keep above the first person who was kept. Normally, keeping the books one after other, the first value inserted will be at the bottom. The first person who kept the book will be at the bottom. The next person who is keeping the book will be above to it. The same way a stack memory works, guys. So one after other. So what happened? Again, the function is called with the value 4. Now what happened? Fact of 4 will be called. Again, n value, I'll check whether it is equals to 1 or 0. So what happened? If this condition is false, it comes to your else part. Here what happened? A value will be n value is 4 into fact of 4 minus 1, that is 3. So again, function of 3 is called. So coming here, fact of 3. So fact of 3. So the function is called. I'll check whether if n value is equals to 3 is equals to 0 or 1. So what happens here is 3 into again fact of 2 will be called. So again, guys, let me write the recursion function again. So repeating the step, let me write directly here. I guess you people are following me. Till 1, that's fine. So let me scroll a little up. So what happened? I'm starting from 5. For each and every iteration, I'm checking whether the particular value is equals to 1 or 0. When my condition fails, I'll go to my else part and I'll mention n into n my fact of n minus 1. So again, the function is called. So this particular operation has been stacked. Again, this calls. So at the last, what happened? It'll be called with the value fact of 1. So when it calls its fact of 1, what happened? Now it will come here. Your condition will be checked whether your fact value is equals to 1. Right now my condition is true. Now the value returned back will be 1. So from your stack memory, one will be returned. So this one is the result of fact of one. So there is a value already. So what happened in this case, 2 into the result of fact of 1 is 1. This will be substituted, which gives you the answer 2 again. So this result 2 is a fact of 2. So what happened? Again, 3 into 2 will be substituted. Result of this will be substituted. So which gives you answer again 6. Clear. So this 6 is a result of fact of 3. So what happened? 4 into 6, which gives you 24. So this fact of 4 is the result. Result is 24. So what happened? 5 into 24, which gives you 120 as your answer. Clear with it? So this 120 will be printed as the answer. This is how it is fetching from your memory. This is how your stack memory works, guys. Your data will be stacked, and after this, one by one data will be taken away. So this is the reason I told you that this particular recursion, applying recursion in a program is not advisable. It occupies memory. Normally, you're not going to store data in your variable. You'll be keeping the data in your stack memory. So if at all you're writing program by using recursion, it occupies a lot of your stack memory, and there arises the problem of stack overflow. One of your issues which you people will be facing in the competitive exam. Fact of 1 will give you 0. How is it? Fact of 1 is 0. Fact of 1 I'm passing, where my n value is 1. What I'm returning here? I'm returning 1 n value. It will return 1 only, right? Yeah, he return just a minute. Okay, then 0. Okay, guys. Okay, fine. I find small. We can return 1 instead of n, we can make it as 1. Then you'll be fine. No return 0. Make it as 1. How somewhere is going to go only till 1, it will never go for 0. This condition is not required. We are going to have only 1 decrementation, right? Okay, so. So let me write here, in case some person has given some exception cases as your n value was 0. So we'll have even 0 factorial is going to give you 1. So we can make it as 1 instead of n, we can make it as 1. So it'll work for all the test cases. Is it clear now? Come on, answer me, guys. Respond to me.
Clear, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah, good. Okay, shall I give one program? Will you try it by tomorrow? Okay, I'll give one small program based on recursion. Okay, tomorrow just I want anyone to try it out, and I want that particular program to be discussed in such class. GCD of two numbers by using recursion. Try it out. Take it as a task. You can try it out. By tomorrow's session, we can discuss this one. By using recursion, I want to do it. GCD of two numbers by using recursion. Okay. Will you people try it out by tomorrow? Yeah, we can discuss by tomorrow this one. Okay, guys. Do you have any doubt in today's session? Whatever we have seen so far?